Having a Gas is the podcast that chats to the great and the good of the creative industries, and in particular finds out what makes great music for film, for TV, for commercials, for cooking to, for dancing to, f***ing to, and more. Today, I'm having a gas with Hugh Todd, an advertising creative director who's done it all. From his humble beginnings as an undergraduate student of building construction technologies here in Manchester, through a string of top-level creative agencies, to eventually becoming one of the most awarded creatives in the business.
Okay, Hugh. So I'll pretend I don't know you, which I do most of the time anyway. What's keeping you busy at the moment?
Great. You seem such a nice bloke.
I know.
Yes, lovely to see you, mate. I'm fine. I'm like the rest of the country, feeling a little bit stir crazy in my house, but feeling very lucky that I'm healthy. And, I've got a family around me, and, it does make you feel quite humble and, lucky to have what I have. But specifically today, if you want a brief breakdown, I woke up, I thought it was 7:30, but it was 6:15. So, and I legged it downstairs, thought I'm going to walk the dog, and I went around the park, and there's literally no one there, which is great. But I've been up for a long time.
Good.
Which is fine. I've been doing loads of things. I'm writing a piece for Shots Mag. I'm preparing for this. I'm going to have to cook dinner soon for the kids. So, yeah, there's always stuff going on.
And how's it going having the kids back around 24/7? How are they coping?
You don't have kids, do you, Greg?
Not yet.
No, that's very mean. I don't know. It's a bit like, this is going to sound mean, and it's not meant to be, but it's like going through a gorge, right? I don't know if you walk through a gorge. So I went with Rach, my wife, through a gorge once. And so the first third of it, you're going, fucking hell, this is like amazing. You're like, it's a divot in the earth's crust, and you're marveling at it, and you're just loving it. And then the middle bit, you go, okay, it's like a kind of gorge, yeah, we're here. And then the last bit is going, get me out of this fucking gorge, I need a beer.
Yes.
So it's been a bit like that so far, which is, oh my God, isn't it great? We're all here, let's party on and have some fun. And isn't it sort of like, it's all new and kind of, I wouldn't say exciting, but it's kind of, there was something kind of interesting and sort of fun about it. And then like in the middle of it, it's going, oh shit, it's going to go on. And now we're in a kind of, it's going on and everyone needs to, we're not built to spend as much time together. So, but I think, we're making a good fist of it. Every now and again, I just say things like, I just feel irritated and I don't explain. And then everyone else has to say the same. So we go to different places in the house.
Exactly what you mean. Yeah, because I was, I think I'm in the same place as you. I was opining this morning that, not to make light of it, the lockdown honeymoon is over. Like, this is the moment where it's properly set in.
Yeah, that's a very good expression. Honeymoon, I'd say, you're on about, could be onto your second or third wife.
Well, I don't know if you saw this morning or yesterday afternoon with Chris Whitty, Chief Medical, saying, don't expect this to end like that. It's not going to go back to normal straight away. Probably not till next year. And I think now it's only just setting in after about a month of denial.
Yeah, I mean, anyway, yeah, that without getting into that too much,
yeah,
I found that slightly a scaremongery thing to say to people. Like, everyone's a bit on edge, give us a bit of hope, fella,
Yeah, well, that's it. And it's not like you've not had your, let's say, you've done a lot of work with the NHS, as your T-shirt shows. Do you want to stand up and give us a bit of a view of the Just Do It? There you go.
Yeah, it's not. I'm not just wearing an NHS top, which is like commendable. So this is a thing. I had this about 2 years now. I just want to say, in case people think I've just bought it. It's an artist called Johnny Bangs, I think. And I was alerted to it when we shot a piece. We shot a piece with a guy called Dan Emerson, a brilliant director, a young guy. And Dan had one. And I said, "Shit, I want one of those."
Yeah.
And he put it onto his website. And I think the government shut it down. I don't know if they. I think now they might not. But I wear it with pride, and I think it. I don't know. I had to have this debate with someone the other day about brands and why this works, and it just has the right feeling for me. And let's get on with it,
Well, before I drag you through a load of music talk, tell us briefly about the work you've done for and with the NHS for those who might not already know.
About 2 years ago, I went to an agency called MullenLowe. And I was, my first week, I was told I was pitching for the NHS, which was an exciting and daunting prospect. And I did it with Louisa Silvern, this wonderful Swedish art director who I ended up working with for 2 years. And we won it with just a very big, simple idea called We Are the NHS. And then it started a kind of 2 year period of just doing loads and loads of work with them. And they're a brilliant client. There's a guy called Ian, who's just an amazing client. And he just loved everything we did, and we had a very easy relationship because he understood advertising, he didn't get in the way. And we had a great time. We shot, I think, about four or five quite big commercials, always in hospitals, always using real staff, everything was real. Part of our pitch was, we said, you know, if you've got a show, it's called 24 Hours in A&E, you can't then run an NHS ad after it, which is all like saccharine and sugar-coated and like done by a lot of wankers in Soho. It's got to be real, you know.
Yeah.
So I mean, it'd still be written by a lot of wankers in Soho, but it, you know, you need to set it. It needs to be real, you know, because all these reality shows are real. So that was our first thing. We and that was our first rule. And then after that, everything kind of fell out quite naturally. So it was an amazing journey. We did stuff specifically for nursing, which was huge. We did thing for male nursing, which is quite a taboo thing still, sadly. There's only 1 in 10 nurses are men, so we need more of those. And we did tons of online stuff for nurses returning. So we got nurses who had been working and returned. As I left, there was a very exciting project, which I can't talk about, but it's one of the most exciting things I've worked on. It wasn't an advert or anything. It's an actual product we're trying to make for the NHS. It's not a visor or anything, or a bib, you know, like for coronavirus. It was something. It's something else. Hopefully, I'll tell you again, hopefully in a few months' time. But it was an incredibly productive and fun period. And, I couldn't speak, obviously, highly enough of the NHS and the way they work with us.
The NHS as such, as a working body, is very much in the news right now. But from a creative perspective, from an advertising perspective, could you like show us behind the curtain of that copy, We Are the NHS? Like, what does that say? What's that trying to get through to me as a viewer?
It's quite a simple line. And to be fair, you know, I've been around the block and I know that it's not a new line. You know, I've seen it on gazillions of things. We didn't openly rip it up off or copy someone. I think we had three routes, and it was just one which sort of surmised how they felt, because they wanted it to be the whole of the workforce, but then it also wanted to be engaging with the public. So the aim was to make people feel pride in the NHS, and then, you know, make them feel so good that they would actually, you know, get involved and become part of it, you know, the recruitment drive. So it's a very emotive piece. I don't think you can have one without the other. You can't go and work somewhere where, let's face it, you're not as well paid as other jobs without some other hook. So the hook is sort of slightly unashamedly emotional. And, you know, every commercial we made, that was our start point. How are we going to dial up this sort of, you know, hugely human quality, and then pull people in and then say, look, come and be part of it. And I think so the we was the whole nation, the we is the whole of the NHS, but the we can be a bunch of nurses, or it can be doctors, or it can be paramedics. You know, it's a very big, what I call a big fat platform idea. You can go and stick it on an email, you can stick it on a massive film, you can put it on your business card, you know, whatever. And you can make the topical ad out of it. I actually did someone's leaving card with it. It's just one of those ones. It's great. I mean, but like I'd say, I'm a pretty spotty creative. I know that the line isn't super like we are, and just put your brand here. Anyone can do that. But it just landed really well for us. And so we went with it. And I think, you know, every time they threw something at us and go, right, it's male nursing. Now it's returning nurses, now it's paramedics, now it's radiographers. It would just fit really well. So it was, I could see why they fell in love with it as a big platform idea.
Despite the fact that I know that you have been creative director on a lot of projects and you've been in the London creative scene, I think, and that this might upset you, since I was in nursery school, I don't know much about I still don't know much about your relationship with music and how it fits into your creative. So maybe we'll shed a bit of light on this, running down these questions. So obviously, number one, is it a vitamin or a painkiller to you? Is music a luxury or is it something that's necessary in your life?
I think it's both and more. Okay. I think, that's not helpful, is it?
Pick a route.
If I give you one from that, it's going to be a really short podcast. I think it depends on the mood, I suppose. I think it's a necessity for me. I love music. I love having it around me, whether I'm working, socializing, trying to sleep, get motivated, cook, dance, drink. You know, the music will always be there as your partner, as Mr. Gas, Gary Hilton, will know. Your music is a huge part of our lives at university. And then when I grew up with Mick, my greatest mate, we were just obsessed with funk. Jazz funk, and then the Gaz, it was more like indie and stuff, and I think that's sort of carried on now. But I suppose I'm a slightly older fella than yourself, as you mentioned, so I kind of I have different tastes for different moments, and it, particularly at the moment with the coronavirus thing keeping people at home, I think music is crucial to people's sanity and their thing. I just met a guy, actually. I was walking around the block to do my regular 11 o'clock power walk before I have a coffee, and I saw my mate Michael, who lives around the corner. We remain 2 meters apart, but he said on Zoom every Friday he has a house party, and someone makes a playlist and they all dance in their little box on the screen, which I thought was brilliant. So you know, I think it's for me it is a necessity. I think the main thing is it's like a drug. You know, music is, it's one of those things, it's one of the closest natural highs you can get. You can stick a tune on, you can feel like tingles all over your body, you can literally feel your skin moving, and you can start singing or dancing, and then this is all free. You know, if you've got Spotify or your CD or whatever, but it's not like you haven't had to go and buy it and sneak outside or do something naughty. It's all there. And so I suppose that's why this is great. I think it's a great idea for a podcast, because music is amazing.
Yeah. Do you actually, so it sounded like the way you were describing it there, you actually use music to influence your mood. You want to change it, as opposed to sensing the mood you have and trying to match music to it.
Yeah, definitely. If I'm going to go for a run, so I need something very, it's all really obvious this, but you know, if you're going for a run, I need something incredibly energetic and lively and slightly naff, I think, to get me in the mood. If I'm cooking, I'll always have jazz. I don't know why, but I just love jazz and cooking and getting into my little zone. And, you know, kind of John Coltrane or Miles Davis or something like that. But then, like, if I'm writing, I'm sorry, Greg, I know this is sort of for later on, but I'm just in the zone now. But sometimes when I write, I think it's either got to be pretty quiet. I think it's a myth to be sitting in an agency environment or any environment with really loud music on. Yeah, I can kind of just vibe with this. I mean, certainly I can't. I have to have my absolute staples are KLF Chill Out, which is one of the finest albums of all time, just because it is a soundscape. But then there are bits in it which go, ooh, like the whenever the sheep come in, I notice my dog pops her head up and like she's going, what's going on? Which I thought was really funny. And then sometimes it's a train that goes from one ear to the other, which if I'm writing, I love that sort of feeling. And then I like a bit of Brian Eno Thursday afternoon, no matter what day of the week it is, I like that. But it's got to be something very backgroundy. There's another guy, I can't remember his name, he's a classical music guy, he's still kind of what's called water music. It's like, if you heard it, you just think, fucking hell, that's really naff. But when you're trying to write or just get into that place, it's really helpful, because it's just, you know, it's sort of, it's not quite whale music, but it's so there's a lot of that going on. And then I think with the kids, because my kids are teenagers now, they're teenage girls, and they're really into music. I mean, massively. It's like one of the biggest parts of their life. So grime music is permanently on in our house, which I find good. I really love it. And I say, that's a riff from James Brown. You know that. Or that's, I don't know, that's from Hamilton by Hammond. Or that's, I don't know, Nitro Deluxe. And I'm like, what are you talking about? And then I'll play it to them and I'll go, oh, yeah. So, yeah, I actually think there's not many moments in this house when there isn't music going. My wife would, I think, love it if it was just a bit quieter.
Music when you're working, it sounded like you don't have anything that marks time, so nothing with punctuation, nothing with a beat.
I've never even thought about it. That's a really good point.
So number two, is there a record that changed your life? Is there something that altered the trajectory significantly?
I think that is one of the meanest questions you can ask someone, but also the greatest, because it's like a Desert Island Discs, they asked for 12 or something, or 8. So I don't know. I did have a think about this earlier today. I mean, I'm going to have 5, right? And I'm not going to spend too long on them apart from one of them, but I'm sure whoever you ask this to is going to come up with all sorts of interesting stuff. I think it's very hard to say if one record changes your life, because your life is in so many different sections. But here it goes. Uncertain Smile by Zaza is an amazing song, both the sax solo and the keyboard solo versions, for the musos out there. And when I grew up with Mick Greeny in Oxford, we were really into jazz funk, actually, and early George Benson and Incognito and stuff like this, Maze. But weirdly, just before the end, when I left to go to university, we got into a bit more of an indie vibe, if that was what it was called, and the other came up and we started really getting into it. So Uncertain Smile, we just loved that. We knew every word to it. We'd sing it along and we'd pissed. And it was like a real moment of me and him. And then, in a similar sort of vein, when I got to Manchester University, I met Gaz, Mr. Gaz, and we had so many tunes we loved, but Walk On by the Stranglers was, we would just listen to it, we would air guitar, and then air keyboard, and then air everything, and then we'd be drinking on the back, terrace with a spliff, and just watch the sun rays and go down, shocking behaviour. But, become one of our sort of tunes, and you just have to hear the first two guitar chords and you're there. And then there's a bit of an, I'm getting more now towards, it's probably the three most important people in my life, my two best mates and my wife. So the next one is, I love early Marvin Gaye stuff. I mean, I love all the Marvin Gaye stuff, but his very early stuff is so amazing. And there's a song called If I Should Die Tonight, which I think is an incredible song. I'm gonna get a bit emotional if I talk about that too much, but it's all about realizing what you've got. Yeah. I Am the Resurrection by the Stone Roses. Completely different, but I love the Stone Roses for millions of reasons. Some bands have 5 albums and all shit, and the Stone Roses had 1, and it was just the most fucking brilliant one ever. Yeah. And I can still play it from the beginning to end. I saw them at Finsbury Park when they were down, and me and Rach loved the Stonies. And I Am the Resurrection is one when we were courting. And we were both a bit nervous of each other. So we'd have to drink a lot of whiskey, and then we'd stick this on and jump up and down on a sofa, and it kind of broke the ice a bit, as you were. But it's such a big question, and I've tried to give it a big answer. So I think my life was changed when I met my wife, Rachel. She's an amazing woman. I'm very lucky to be married to her. And hopefully she feels the same about me. And on our wedding day, we had a dance. You know, when you get married, Greg, this Islam team, you have a dance and everyone has to watch. And it's a kind of classic, you know, everyone sort of does that. And we chose a dance from Saturday Night Fever, one of our favourite films. And it's John Travolta and Stephanie, the character Stephanie. And there it's More Than a Woman. And it's their first showcase dance at this club, and so we learned this dance in the front room of our flat and reenacted it at the wedding. And it was definitely, there's so many things, because the song's called More Than a Woman, which is, she's more than a woman to me. It was great feeling dancing in front of my mates, but for a split second I thought I was John Travolta.
Yeah, that is the natural consequence.
I won't reenact it here now, but you know, maybe next time we'll give it a go. But it was there's a lot of associations with it. And recently, a friend of mine, Paul Tatlock, Tatty, Mr. T, framed the single and sent it to me with an anniversary plaque on it. And it's in the corridor upstairs in the house. And yeah, so it's a biggie. That's the biggie.
And you've already touched on this a bit, but if there's any more depth, tell me how music's playing a part in your life during COVID-19, during the lockdown.
I don't know, the COVID-19 thing, it's like, it hasn't changed that much. I think I'm still into the same tunes and stuff. I think, if I'm being really honest, I don't listen to the radio so much. I'm really scared of listening to the radio because I get very, so basically what I do in the morning, we'd have Radio 4 on for the news. So that's fucking out now. I just don't want to hear any news because it just sends me into a spiral of despair. And then I'd probably put Six music on. So I love Six. And I used to love it when Sean Keaveney was on Breakfast. I kind of like Lauren Laverne, not as much, although I'm getting into it now. So that would kind of be my music, but I'd normally go to work. So if I'm here, I can't have music all day because I'm doing lots of different things. But if I'm writing, like I said, I'll have a very chilled out piece. But I think under this sort of circumstance, we need to change the moods in the house. In the mood in the house, quite quickly. Sometimes people can get really upset. There's four of us. We're all girls, really. I'm a bit of a girl, and so we're all quite moody. And so I think music can really help that, or it can really screw things up. Like, so I think it does play a huge part. And then in my house, all these houses are right next to each other, like everywhere in London. We're all on top of each other. And so you can hear music come over the fence or through the wall. So weirdly, last night, I think I was in the garden doing something, and I heard there's 2 houses down, there's some doctors and nurses, believe it or not, living there, and we love them, and we always clap them on a Thursday, you know. And I heard them playing Sister Sledge, Thinking of You. And I was like, oh, God, I love that. So I legged it. I came inside, quickly got on Spotify, and we're all singing along to it. And I love that way of, so that was a kind of taking someone else's music just organically over the fence, you know?
Yeah.
I think generally, I think it's been big. I think its role has just been amplified because I already rely on music a lot in my life. So it hasn't changed too much. I think I've probably been listening to a little bit more chilled out stuff, and I've also been doing more podcasts. I know that's not music, but it is a kind of, it's a piece of audio, and it's so, you know, this is a podcast now, and I've got mine, and it's huge, but it's very calming hearing another voice in a room, which you don't, like, I listen to 2 or 3 podcasts which I just don't have to tune into, like Komodo Mayo or Adam Buxton or someone, they're just like chattering away, and I quite like the company. You know, like that. I think that's how we're coping.
Yeah, it's good on the podcast thing. It's like what obviously the purpose of talk radio served, but it can be so much more specific. Obviously, you know, you do one, and you know so many in the creative community, but. When did you notice the sort of the podcast big bang? Because obviously now it looks like there's 10 a penny, here's another. But it feels like 5 years ago, they weren't so, you know, they weren't everywhere.
God, yeah. It's a good question, Greg. I don't know. I mean, like you said, everyone's doing it and they're great. And you can have them the most niche subject possible. I think the Komodo Mayo one was the film one I liked. And I've been listening to that for a very long time. It's very soothing because it gives you a really good update on films. But they're very clever the way they chat because they're incredibly aware of people's mental health and issues that affect people and how just listening to a couple of blokes chatting can make people feel better. Because you just don't know what's going on behind closed doors, especially now in coronavirus, how people's only connection with the outside world might be a podcast or a phone call or a Zoom thing. So I think pods are amazing at that. I started listening to, I think probably, what's his name? I forget his name now. Malcolm Gladwell. I started listening to his stuff, you know, Tipping Point and Blink and all of that. You know, I was interested to hear him, and he's got an amazing voice. So as well as his writing is good, that's the other thing on pods, I think. If you like the voice, I listened to this one called Series, actually, which was about a murder. And it was done, it was the original one. It was done in real time. A guy had killed someone who's in jail. He'd been tried. And this American woman, I'll remember her name in a minute, and she is Sarah, it'll come back to me. She's got an amazing voice, fantastic, really kind of listenable to, is that a word? And so I got really into that. So I did that whole series. But I have no idea if that was at the beginning, but it's certainly a few years ago. And I could see how people were into it, but it seemed like kind of quite complicated or a, you know, I don't know, it's something for other people, but actually it's, you know, it's very very democratic, isn't it? Everyone can actually, you just need a microphone, right? And a
Yeah. I think the first thing for me was noticing that, you know, Joe Rogan had become probably the most listened to and watched broadcaster in the world, just on the strength of his podcast, where, you know, he invites random people in. There's no brief, there's no theme to his podcast. And it's the fact, I think, that people are talking in a conversational way, you know, as opposed to in traditional media where it has to be very tight because you've got your 5 minutes. I think people, like you said, enjoy listening to the music of conversation rather than a bullet point in a script.
Yeah, absolutely. And also, like I said, I like radio because it's like a friend in the room and you don't have to follow a narrative or anything. But the trouble is with radio at the moment is I just find it really depressing. And even if it's not a news program like Radio 4, which is amazing, but I can't do with hearing all the updates and the news. It's just depressing. So then if you listen even to Risk 6 Music, though, every half hour there will be news. So I kind of just think, like your thing about no full stops, I just don't want to be in a place where I'm going to be in a live place. So that's what a podcast does. You know, like you said, you stick it on, it's a bit of company, but it's not live. And I like that. So you're in control of it as well, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm going to open my bottle. It's not alcoalcoic, it's ginger beer. I just, I'd like to add, but I'm going to make some noise.
No, that's, yeah, everybody in the room, make some noise for Hugh's non-alcoholic ginger beer.
Cheers,
there you go. Was there any music that your parents did not like you listening to?
I don't know, really. I think when I was a kid, I was best mates with this guy, Mick, who I'm still great friends with now, as I talked about. And I liked him because he was from the other side of the tracks. But, you know, and he had, like, all the things I wanted. Like, he had ITV. They had takeout food. They had the Sun newspaper. I mean, they were all literally in our house. I just didn't know these things existed. ITV, no way. The BBC, there's organic homemade food by my mother, which was great. But at the time, you know, as a kid, you always want the other thing. And so, and in music, it was the same. Mick was, his brother was really into jazz funk, and we got into jazz funk, but I kind of wasn't really allowed to go and buy any or anything. And so we'd go around to his and listen to it really loud, and there was no problem with that. And so when I tried doing that at home, I used to get a bit of a bollocking. So I think, I don't even know whether it was the type of music, just the loud or just the sort of volume. But I think before that, I was into the Beatles, you know, like everyone else. And I remember recording the Beatles on a tape recorder, holding the microphone, you know, to the record player. And you could hear my mum in the background saying, "Dinner's ready," and all that. So it's kind of quite a comedy, but I think we listened to the top 20, you know, and you'd press play and record on the tracks you loved, or sometimes you'd try and record the whole top 20. You'd have to get a C60 and turn it over.
Yeah.
Oh, those days. But I think, yeah, I don't think mum and dad hated funk or jazz funk or anything I listened to that much. I think it was just the volume. And I always have this obsession, which I'm sure you lot have, and anyone who's into their tunes, a decent intro in a track, got to hear loud. So I used to just get this, whatever the track was, Cameo or whoever, and I'd just whack it up, and I'd just love it. And I'd wait for them to come in and go, "Turn that down," you know, and it'd be like one of those.
Yeah, all right. So so your parents were cool, but are you cool? Is there anything that we've obviously touched on, grime, with the young'uns? Is there anything that unsettles you?
Yeah, I was thinking about this. I mean, it's kind of, I don't actually hate any of the music, and this is going to sound really pretentious and wanky, okay, but I'm going to say it, because I'm hoping they inherit my eclectic taste of music. There you go, said it, eclectic wanker.
Yeah.
because I love, you know, everything from like Stranglers and punk. Then I got into funk. Then I got into kind of like, I don't know, do you call it new wave or indie? And then, I don't know, just everything like classical. I love classical, you know, and then chill out. And then, I mean, I don't want to name every musical genre there is, but I've got a very broad taste. I just heard some Pearl Jam on Keaveney's lunchtime show just now. I love Pearl Jam. Eddie Vedder.
Doesn't get any better than that. Yeah.
So you kind of go, but that's the thing I was saying about music, you know, it's like a drug and it just gets better. And the more you dig into it and explore and find, the more you think, oh God, I love, you know, I love London Grammar, but then I love, I don't know, Miles Davis, but then I love, and you kind of draw, someone did this, sure you're aware of this, these rock family trees where, you know, when someone leaves a band and forms another band, and then that bloke went out of someone and made, and they're these huge sort of like bits of DNA really for music, but how, yeah. You know, Led Zeppelin are related to, I don't know, The Who or whatever, there'll be some way through it. And that is a bit like our taste in the way you can go, well, I got into New Order because I met Gaz, and then because of Gaz I got into a band, and then, you know, and I love that about music. It is one of those things that it just keeps giving. Sorry, so in a very roundabout way, I'm going to get back to your question, which is, my kids, they like a lot of grime music, or, you know, slightly aggressive rap. They're not, I don't think there's any driller. Maybe we do have driller, I'm not sure. But they've been to Wireless. And actually, I love some of the music, it's fantastic. It's like, you know, kind of like I was saying, it's sort of redolent of funk and, you know, hip-hop and soul. I kind of just get a bit knacked off some of the lyrics, that they're quite misogynistic sometimes, and I sort of say, look, you shouldn't try not to listen to that one, but, you know, they don't. I'm not going to give them a heavy hit on that, because that's me being a dad, and I'm a bit of a dad already quite a lot of time. But then the other day I was thinking, I couldn't believe it. They were upstairs, and I listened. So first of all, I heard Oasis, and then I heard the Beatles, and I was like, oh, that must be someone else over the hedge. And it was them. And I said, was that you? And she said, yeah, no. We're into a bit of that, Dad. And I was like, okay, great. So, you know, the journey continues. Like, you know, the education, and I hadn't sort of forced it on them. I think the trouble is, if I say, hey, listen to this, this is great, they think, oh, shit, Dad, tell us what to do again. The thing that is a bit weird in this house, which is the thing, I'll go and get it, it's the... It's these things.
Is that an Alexa? No.
No, oh, it's not.
No. I've got one of those here in white. Yeah, that fella.
Yeah. Oh, mate. Yeah. Hey. So, it's just a speaker. But when we went on a holiday a few years ago, the house we were staying in had these, and they were amazing. So we bought everyone one of these. But then the trouble is, everyone just walks, and they're obviously incredibly powerful, brilliant quality. You know, so everyone just, Dorothy particularly, my youngest, and I quite often walk around with your speaker going, here I come, this is me, get out of the way. So sometimes we clash. And then also we clash as in our Bluetooths get confused.
Yeah.
So then sometimes it's double aux, because then like she might be having a conversation with a friend which just starts coming through on some my thing. And I'm like, turn it off! Yeah! Stop it! So yeah, I mean, I actually really like... This is quite a rich time, I think, as a parent with a child, because if they go into a tune together, like, so Dorothy will actually come in and play a tune, and I'm going, what is that? That's brilliant. So I'll shazam it. I'll grab it. And then she'll teach me a TikTok, and then we'll do a TikTok together. Obviously, it has to be a very easy one, because I'm a bit crap. But then I'll go, wow, that's like a moment in time just wrapped up. And it's like, and that all comes from the power of music. It's not from anything else. You couldn't have TikTok without music, you know. So, I love the way technology advances your enjoyment of music, and how you can not only share it with each other, but then she can then, well, I don't think she'd share the video of me with her, but she dances with guys in Germany and America and everything, because they do that sort of screen thing. She just copies them, and it's mind blowing how technology enhances music to take you to a special place.
Yeah, I mean, that's relevant to you as well, isn't it? As a creative director, as a guy who's been around in the scene for a while, all I see all the time, conversation in the creative world, campaign, shots, et cetera, is trying to, what would you say, mechanize new technologies to get the most bang for the advertiser's buck, to get the, you know, most return on investment for the client. And there's always this argument going on saying, no, it's about the strength of the creative. The creative is that the trunk that stays forever. And the branches are these little YouTube adverts and TikToks, obviously Snapchat advertising, Instagram adverts. Yeah. And so, well, it's interesting that, you know, the creative, the music, those are those strong things that continue. But how do you, I just wanted to hook back onto that and get your take on that little dichotomy that's going on. What do you think about the current trend for trying to cram creative into little 5-second adverts on YouTube and Instagram?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. I think a cliched response would be, that's rubbish, can't do it, it's not as good as the old days. But that's, you can't be like that in the modern world. You have to evolve. I mean, I think you just have to be aware of what that space is trying to do. If it is only 5 seconds, then you're just giving someone a little taste or a little snippet or just a little tease or, you know, a little sample of something. It's like a tasting menu. It's not the main meal. So, I like being part of something bigger. So if my only job was just to produce those little things, yeah, I'd be... I'm not sure if that's what I'm built for that. But I do like doing the big thing. And then I appreciate that you go, okay, we've made a 90-second piece of content, which, you know, might be, that's a rich piece of content. That's a film, online, maybe it's cinema, possibly on TV, if you know, maybe like get even like one of those ones that takes over the whole break. But then that'll be chopped up into tiny little pieces. And so one of them might appear at the front of some YouTube content as a pre-roll, and you go, okay, well, you know, if you're smart enough, you'll be able to use a little bit of it. I think the problem is when you go, that's the only bit you got. Then you go, you're starting from a space like that big. So if you're starting from, like, if you're a brand and you've got this big thing and you go, right, I'm going to just use that little bit there for pre-roll. We're going to have some of this for radio. This is going to be posters. You know, you kind of go, okay, fair enough. And that's what I always want to be part of, a big campaign.
As long as you can stick it all back together and it makes a whole.
Yeah. I think there is a trend, though, for like, obviously, you know, there's always going to be people who are going to go in quick and fast and let's do that. But that's like any business. They're going to do that. But it's invariably, yeah, I don't know. I don't think it won't sustain for me, really, I think. Because then that's like going, I've got 5 seconds to get the brand across, get our tone of voice, get our product in, get an end line. What do you want me to do? You know, like, you can only do one thing. You do one thing, and you know, you have to. It's all, you know. It's, you have to go right back to basics, and you go, okay, if it's a series of pre-rolls, or if it's a series of, I don't know, GIFs or whatever, then have a big idea about how to use that technology, or you know. I mean, it's not quite the same. I saw Kim Gehring did that brilliant Chaka Khan promo where she just used this throughout the... there's people dancing, but they're just moving like every 3 seconds. That's all they do. But she sewed them all together. Absolutely amazing. So, you know, that kind of quick snap culture we're in, this sort of 5 second, 3 second thing. As long as you can like subvert it or make it work for you, that's fine. I think if that's all you did, I think you may go potty.
yeah. I think some of the more... There was a project we were involved in last year, and I won't say the client or the agency, but the fact is, it was, can you compose a 10-second track for an Instagram advert? And that was the only deliverable. And it was probably the most agonizing that's ever been done over a single piece of content.
Yeah. The smaller jobs with no money and those type of things are probably the most painful. You know, when someone can say, oh, look, can you just quickly do us a quick little radio ad, or like, can you just write this little Instagram thing. They end up being like, you know, quite fraught affairs because people have got so little money or so little time that their little bit they're really, really worrying about. You know, it's like asking, I don't know, asking quite a builder who does quite big jobs to, I don't know, just paint the top of your wall. It's sort of, but then you'll get fussy about it. It's sort of, it feels like, yeah, sometimes it's just, you know, you just got to grit your teeth and do it.
Yeah, yeah. What's the best music that you have seen in an advert? And it can be synced or composed bespoke, but what's the best one in your opinion?
That's nearly as mean, not quite as mean as your...
What's one record?
Change Your Life. But anyway, it's not, because my life isn't all about advertising, and it shouldn't be. So there are less brilliant adverts for great music on than there are great bits of music. However, there are, oh God, there are so many good ones. I thought of two I'm just absolutely in love with. The first one is called Drugstore by Levi's, and this was by BBH, probably at the peak of their powers. Adam and I just joined them, oh Christ, it must have been the mid to late 90s, and BBH were just, they had Levi's, Boddington's, Audi, Lynx, Murphy's, Johnny Walker. They just had this incredible client list. And at the time, believe it or not, Levi's were the fucking coolest shit ever. They were like the jeans that everyone wore. Whereas now they're kind of like, I think they're kind of, obviously they're there still, but there's a gazillion other brands. But at the time, Levi's were the main brand in Britain. And every time the creative brief came out, the creatives would be like agonizing to make it, because it was like the most high profile work you could do. John Hegarty did the original one, which was like Heard It Through the Grapevine, where the guy, Nick Kamen, goes into a laundrette, puts his jeans in and puts a load of stones in. And it looks really weird. And he just sits in his boxer shorts. I'm sure you've seen this, but you haven't looked it up. You're probably too young. But then he comes out and they're stonewashed and just puts them on. I mean, at the time, you can't imagine how mad it was. Nick Kamen became this sort of superstar supermodel. Heard It Through the Grapevine, went for number one. Levi's sold, you know. So it became this, it's about the John Lewis act, you know, what's the next one? Anyway, long story short, so this is when Levi's had, you know, done quite a few years of it, and the pressure every year to do another one was great. And there's a team called John Gorse and Nick Worthington, who's just somehow every year just smashed it out of the park. Everything they did was amazing. And I think this was them probably at their best. And it was basically, so it's a drugstore. So basically it's a guy who goes to buy a condom at the drugstore. Yeah. And then in the evening, he goes to pick up his girlfriend, and the guy who opens the door was the guy who sold him the condom. So it's like a kind of, it's an old gag, but it was someone actually called it a Benny Hill gag, which is slightly unfair, but possibly it is. But then the way it's directed, Michel Gondry, you know, the absolute legend, he's gone on to do incredible movies in Hollywood. He was doing a lot of promo work at the time, he was really hot, and this was his sort of high point in commercials. And it was all shot in black and white, and it was just amazing. It's absolutely amazing. It was a great idea. It was brilliantly directed, but the absolute, you know, the topping, the kind of gold with the music. And then any commercial, it's 50%. But this, there's something about it. I found out it's, excuse me, give me a minute. It's called Novelty Waves. Biosphere is the band. And it was it's a kind of like slightly drum and bass track. So on its own, if you listen to it, you go, oh yeah, that's quite a nice track. But when you put it to the film, it just hits every sync point. And I remember just getting shivers down my spine watching it, because it was just, everything worked. It's so annoyingly brilliant. You couldn't find a chink anywhere. The end line, because the end line was something like, watch pocket invented 1873, and then it said abused ever since. Great line and great direction, great idea, shocking at the time. I mean, I'm actually getting excited, I'm getting tingles thinking about it. So that that music, that was amazing. If it was going to be topped, it was only going to be topped by one other team, and that's Tom and Walter. Tom Carty and Walter Campbell, they did the Guinness Surfer commercial, which has probably been voted the greatest commercial of all time. Right, so, so again, it's a bit obvious, but the way the track syncs with the film, it's just perfect as well. So quite often, you'll have a great bit of music, and you put it to the film, and you're going, yeah, it doesn't really work. And yes, great tracks, David Bowie, whatever. You go, yeah, but it doesn't work with the film. And then, you know, sometimes it'll be the other way around. They've got to come together. And if they do, then you're going, wow. And I'm always surprised, you know, sometimes you put a track on and you see the film and it starts to edit. It's like they kind of knew each other were coming. You know, like the edit starts syncing up. It's just like amazing. And you go, fuck, we've got a winner here. So, although I think on Tom and Walt, when they did it, I think they spoke because they were so cool. They were just so ahead of the curve. They knew Left Field, the guys who wrote the song. So I don't know whether they hooked it all up before even, because they were single released as the Surfer commercial came out. But what I love about it again is there's this dialogue at the beginning of the Surfer commercial where it goes tick follows tock, and it's written by Tom and Walt, but then it feels like it's just part of the song. It feels like it's, you know, they're all together. It's not like, hey, here's a piece of film, here's a piece of music, and we kind of trying to glue them together. This was like, it's just one thing. And it's amazing. And it, again, the Left Field track is kind of like sort of nightclubby. I don't know if I'd play it on its own that much. It's quite cool. But like I said, when you put it with the film, it's just amazing. I mean, I'll never forget when I first saw it. So I knew Tom really well. Tom and Walter, we used to show our book to when we were kids. And he told me when it was going to be on. It was United. Of playing Bayern Munich in the Champions League final, and it was on they were going to get the treble if they'd won it. And I was at the Haverstock Arms and the Haverstock Hill in Hampstead with all my mates and getting right royally drunk. And it came on, and that was the first time it was on, and everyone in the pub watched it and went, you know, like it was just one of those spine tingling moments. Great ad, great night. It was like amazing,
yeah. And I've never considered that. Really quite romantic idea that you just put forward, that a piece of music can somewhat be orphaned floating in space waiting for the right piece of film to be synced to, and then it's as if it was written bespoke for it.
That's a lovely way of putting it, orphaned. You know your stuff, don't you, Greg?
I don't know, not yet. I think I just listen to people like you and I'm good at faking it, but...
I think that's because otherwise, joking aside, you'll end up... You have to believe that. Otherwise, you're going to get into this fucking... the data nonsense. Like, quite often... So, if we're looking for a piece of music, you can brief some people, and they'll just take a keyword out of the title of the piece of work you've talked to them about, and they'll put it into a... I don't know, like some sort of word search thing, and just send a bunch of songs with the word sunshine in. And you're going, yeah, but you've got to go further than that. And that's always what throws me a bit about music, because we wouldn't exist if there was a formula to choose the right music every time. And believe me, there's still no formula. You know, you talk to composers, you do searches, you make it up yourself. Is it going to be sound effect? You know, that's what I love about putting an audio track to a piece of film. You just never know what it could be or will be. So it might be a tune. It might be a composed film, you know, it's, and so I kind of, there's never one way of doing it so far.
There's an absolutely brilliant one that, if you haven't seen it, I recommend it, and I'll send you a link, that came out in February by Leo Burnett for McDonald's, obviously. And I think the creatives were called Steph Ellis and Rory Hall. But right. I found it to be a really moving piece, and I think it's called McDonald's Night Workers, and it's about...
Oh, yeah.
Did you see it?
Yes, very good.
Yeah, so that was one of those, you know, where it evoked a response that I wasn't prepared for, because usually, you know, because I'm relatively young, I can still be quite cynical about advertising, being like, all right, where's the bit that it's going to try and get me to buy the thing? But I found it really moving.
But then, see, McDonald's and Leo's brilliant relationship, and they but then McDonald's are somebody they invest in advertising. They invest in great ideas. You can see it. It's that they have a heritage. You know, if you look back at their kind of, if you watched a reel of their ads over the last 10, 20 years, you'd see, oh yeah. You know, I know like people run McDonald's down and stuff, but you know, as it's sort of fast food, but it's, you know, I kind of don't see any. I just see like a brand, just a brilliant brand, and they really listen to their agencies. You know, not just Leo's in Britain. You know, around the world, McDonald's. They really. I love brands who invest in advertising and believe in the power of music. You know, because it's 50% of the commercial. And if you're with a client who understands that, I mean, one of our nurses spots. So I'm going to digress here a bit, but the direct. It's not always the agent, you know, you never know where it's coming from. It might be an agency idea who get the music. It might be a director. It might be an editor. Quite often I'll go to a first edit and we go, oh, I'll just get an editor to put a track on. Yeah. Just stick something on and we'll figure the music out. And then you come in and you're going, oh my God, that is brilliant. And so you kind of always hope that's going to happen. But then quite often from the outset, you like on one of our ads, me and Lou had, we had this track, I'm a Man. For the nurse, a male nurse one, it sounds obvious, but it's a really great tune and it was really emotional. It's Spencer Davis Group, and we just knew that's what we wanted. And that we edited to that. We said to the director, this is the track. But then on the most recent commercial, the one 2 ago, we worked with this amazing director called Billy Boyd Cape from Academy Films. Billy's an amazing director, really young, super energetic, just an amazing guy. And he said from the outset when he pitched to us,
a minute on the job.
He said, and this is the music track you'll hear. And it's quite a brave thing to do, because quite a lot of directors go, it's going to be a bit like this, and you know, it would be this sort of casting. But you know, you're keeping your options open, right? Because you're thinking, especially in the NHS, because we're going to be a real hospital, you don't quite know what's going to happen. But Billy put his neck out and said, you've got this track. It's this one, and then I'm going to shoot. And he put everything in, and I went, oh my God, this, you've got to go with it. And it was funny enough, Greg, it was a track that he said he listens to when he writes. And he said it's an 8-minute bloke for some, I think it's a, I should know the name. Sorry, guys, can't remember it. Like some sort of German or Italian composer. Again, it's, you'd never find it, you'd never know it was there, but it's in his noodle. And it was brilliant. And again, someone might go, where'd you get the music from? And you go, oh, the director came up with it straight away. Or sometimes you're going, it was the last minute and we finally got, you know, so it's a very, it is very arbitrary.
It's interesting that it sounds like, from the way you're describing it, the music and advertising is a sync business, and bespoke is less the thing you'll grasp for immediately. Why do you think that is?
I don't know now. I think it might. I don't know. Maybe I'm not sure if that's right. I think.
Okay.
I think you end up with the music you end up with. It doesn't really help, but because of the job you're on. So if you go, because I know one of your questions was, have you ever been irritated by a client not choosing the music you want? But I kind of, if I'm going to be a bit mature about it, you kind of end up with what you deserve, because, or you end up with what's appropriate, because, you know, there's a budget. So, you know, budget is one of the main issues. There's taste in music. So, you know, that's the most contentious, most polarizing thing in the world, music on an advert. I hate it. Why? Don't know. Give me another one. Don't know. You know, just, you know, and you go, but that's like my best mate composed that. It's brilliant. No, don't like it. My wife hates it. You know, so kind of, it's very subjective. So there is no, I find it really, it's quite a tense moment in the process. But then you end up with, you only end up as good as your client. Because ultimately they are the final decision maker. They're paying for the work. You know, it's their thing. So you can moan as much as you like, but if you haven't put something in front of them, they like. So I think you do end up with what you end up with. I'm not a believer in sour grapes at all. I think you look at the work and you go, well, that was what was affordable, and that was what the client liked. And it was our fault if we didn't, you know, change them. So I'm kind of, I think music's huge, and I think as an agency or as a creative, you have to be really ready to keep going, go again, try something new, scrap it, do sound effects, sing it yourself. I don't know. It's just because it's such an amazing world out there of music. It's so naive to just go, oh, I don't like the track. We've got, oh, go again then. You know, so I'm very cool with, you know, I don't believe in if someone rejects it, it's over. I go, well, we'll get something else. You know?
Well, that's probably a good segue to the next thing, which was because originally I just phrased it as young composers. But I also, I really mean young artists, young people who are creative, right? Obviously, you know, this one's coming. Why should young creative types, artists, illustrators, filmmakers, musicians, work in advertising as opposed to in other media? There's a cynical underbelly to the question, which is a lot of people I know view advertising as, well, you're just selling someone else's stuff and you're using a kind of magic show to sell it.
Money.
Yeah, good luck making money being an artist is the very cynical answer, right?
I mean, look, you say it in jest and it's a quick and funny, but it's sort of true. Advertising is where art meets commerce, you know, and I think as a young lad, I used to, maybe I've had my moment of reason, I still think it's like kind of an art form and all, people are messing about on my words and that, but ultimately it's a business. And that's in the business of, you know, selling products or creating awareness and blah, 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 blah. So there is room for artists in it. But I think it all has to be, you know, for a reason or a cost or for a budget. So I would sort of approach it the other way around. If I was a composer, an illustration artist, I wouldn't actively go and work in advertising. I would do my own thing and wait to be discovered, because then that's interesting. Cause I go, oh God, why don't we, you know, let's get that guy to those fly posters for that album, for that band. So somebody's nothing to do with advertising. And you go, well, I want that, you know, what I don't want is something already in advertising because that's just feeding itself and it's not new. You know, the whole thing is as creative people in advertising, you want to find something new. It's sort of, you know, it's insatiable, the demand for it, but it is, because that's what's going to make you memorable and what's remember your commercial and remember the brand and blah, 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 blah. So I think, you know, if I would say, yeah, advertising is what it is. I mean, I saw a short film 2 days ago. I really liked it. And I wrote to the woman. And I said, I loved your film you just did. And I think she wrote the music as well. And she said, oh, thank you. And we had a nice little chat. And then I said, do you ever do commercials? And she said, oh, no, not yet. But, you know, I'd love to be interested. I said, look, okay, well, look, you know, I'd love to work with you at some point. So that's how, for me, it works. Because you never know when you might need that person. Someone might say, oh God, we need a director with this sort of touch or that, or we need someone new, or someone hasn't done ads before. You know, you're constantly looking for new inspirations or something which isn't what everyone else is doing. I hate it, but I get incredibly jealous if I see a brand or a competitor or someone doing something really cool, which I hadn't thought about. So like, I don't know, mixing animation and live action, say first person who did that, you go, God, that was good. You know, the NSPCC ad where there's a kid and it's an animated kid and it's like, God, it's really clever. And you think, shit, I wish I'd done that. And so maybe the creatives had seen a short film which had that in. So I think all of these things like short films and illustration, people do illustrations and, you know, they're all working in their own sort of space. And I suppose if they wanted to get into advertising, they can. But I think it's sort of, in a way, it's better to try and get discovered or, you know, gently be introduced like that. I think if you actively go into advertising, I think it's fine as a creative because that's your goal. You want to create for advertisers. But I think if you just said, I'm going to just write music for adverts, then you'll end up just writing music like all the other adverts and then it'll be a quick and slow death. Not quick and slow, but that's contradictory, a quick death. But I think if you go, do you know what? I just love making music. I'm going to make a promo. I'm going to do something for my friend's short film. I'm going to do something to help someone's kids sleep. And I will actually might do something for a mate of mine. He's in advertising. I'll do. So you kind of, you know what I mean? You kind of have those different areas to develop your skill. Not sure if I've answered your question.
No, you have. It's interesting because I was reading, I went on Dave Dyer's blog, as you recommended, and a long interview with Bill Birnbach, and he was talking about his way into the industry, and Bill B of DDB said, it's because I wrote something to get into an agency, but the reason they liked me was because he wasn't an ad man. He said, my mind was uncluttered by culture. He didn't know how to think like an advertiser, which gave him an advantage.
Yeah, no, that's a very good way of putting it. I think that's what we're permanently trying to do, I think, is to not think too much like an advertising person. So then when your adverts come out, they appear, you know, different and they stand out. And that is a skill. And to keep doing that, you have to keep looking at new ways of doing things, I think.
Yeah. Do most creatives within agencies, do they usually have side hustles? They're usually making something else, trying not to just feed the beast.
I think it has become a bit of a thing, which people do, which is, I think it's great in a way, because it gives your brain a rest from advertising, and it's like a kind of, you're going to give it another workout, but in another place. So if you write poetry, or you like to, I don't know, write music, it's brilliant, right? So then it's like giving your brain a rest. So then when you come back to the advertising, it's like you've had a nice little holiday, but not just a holiday, you've also done something which could actually feed back into your day job, as it were. Although I always think there's not really a day night thing, you're always on a little bit. But I think it's good. I think the only trouble with it is, as long as it doesn't become your main thing, or you're doing it because you're a bit shit at being a creative, or you haven't had much success. I don't know. I think I'm very up for focusing on the work and making sure you're doing everything you can to make great work, whether it is on an account you've been put on or proactively work on other accounts. Because, you know, most agencies have a brilliant roster of clients. And even if they don't, you could proactively go out and say, I want to do some ads for the local restaurant or for a courier service, or I don't know, you know, there's a whole world out there that which you could give your services to. But I think you're right. I think if you just write ads all the time, you will quickly become quite sort of one dimensional, and you need to continually take inspiration from other places and maybe flex your creative muscles and other things. Because then, like I said, when you come back, so I had about 3 or 4 months off a couple of years ago, and then I ended up doing a short story writing course, and I did a course on meditation. I did like a bunch of stuff which I'd never do normally. I came back in, I felt really refreshed. I felt like I was just starting over. It's brilliant. Well, rather than feeling a bit, oh God, you know, here we go again. I never feel like that. I always feel like, right, let's go. You know, that's so I think that's really important. But I only found that out because I left a job which I wasn't that happy in. So I think, you know, you have to kind of, every cloud has a bit of a silver lining.
We've gone over the hour mark, so we're going to do the last two questions, and we'll wrap it up. So first one,
right?
Best creative shop you've worked for. Which one was it, if you can say?
BBH under John Egerty was amazing. Like I talked about a little bit earlier, it was absolutely incredible. So that was probably, it was an amazing experience. And then when I went to Saatchi's, worked under Dave Droger, just for a very short period, about 2 years relatively, but it was incredible. And the way he drove that agency, and Hegarty and Droger were really opposite characters. Hegarty was very measured and very cool, you know, very erudite and, you know, quite classy. You know, the BBH output was very slick, and cool, whereas Droger was a bit more like just seat the pants, make stuff happen. Just don't fucking think about it. You know, and they were both incredibly successful at different ways of doing it. So yeah, those are the two agencies I thought were great.
What about a shop you haven't worked for that you think is awesome and you would love to?
Yeah, it's really quite a long list, I think. I love Mother. Everything Mother do is brilliant. I love the way they were. Droga 5. So I suppose I could sort of half claim that, so I worked under Droga, but Droga 5, wherever, Mother and Droga 5, wherever they are in the world, they're amazing. Same with Wieden Kennedy, absolutely phenomenal. I think Adam and Eve, obviously, is just a brilliant British agency who seemed loved around the world as well. So yeah, I mean, all of those would be great. I think I'm fine though. You know, I don't hanker about wanting to work for one of them now. But if one of them, if I got a chance, I'd do it. I think one thing though, you don't have to work for a trendy agency. I think it's where your head's at and the briefs you got in front of you. You know, so you have to apply yourself. You could have the greatest opportunity in front of you at a slightly shitter agency. But if you don't see it and hanker, it's like, you know, the grass is greener. You might have actually the best looking girl in town. You just don't know it. Or, you know, you can do a Leicester City. You know, Leicester City, were they going to win the league? No, but they did. So I think it's always about what you've got in front of you.
And, you know, for all these, for all the cool brands, there was a time when they were just one of the B-list clients at someone else's agency, you know, that launched the agency.
Exactly. The one thing I was going to mention, sorry, just want a quick word about Honda.
Yeah,
Wieden Kennedy. The whole, everything Wieden Kennedy did on Honda was incredible because it was that thing. It was new. Everything they did was like, wow. Never seen animation like that. I've never seen a cog turn for, you know, 2 minutes to turn the thing on to do the thing. Blah blah blah. But I thought music was incredible. Grr was a song written by a creative based on a speech from Honda's CEO or president about how disgusting diesel engines were. And that is amazing. Not only was it brilliant written, it was brilliantly performed, and it was outstanding black pencil. And then the other one I loved of that was choir. So they got a choir to sing the sound effects of a Honda. I mean, when you just say that sentence, you smile and go, oh, that'd be good. And then how the fuck do you do that? Well, we'll find out. So I think Honda... anything, I know we've talked about this before, if you're doing a thing about music or sound, Honda and Sean and all the guys, Tony Davidson, anyone at Wieden Kennedy, they definitely deserve a mention. They're outstanding work.
Well, I'm going to make it my business to talk to them about these projects because they've obviously got a lot that we need to hear.
Good man. Sorry, I think that's it. I knew that was one of the things I wanted to talk to you about, but that's it.
It's quite all right. And so, but you've... give me a lot of time, and that's there's obviously a lot of it going about at the moment. Time's a less valuable currency.
Exactly, Greg. Well, you've got a good moment, you know.
Obviously, we were meant to get you up to Manchester at the start of this month. God willing, we'll be able to do it.
I'll be there, mate. Before you can say zoom, I'll be there.
But it's been great speaking to you, and I look forward to doing it again.
Brilliant. Thanks, Greg. Real pleasure. Take care of yourself, mate.
And you.